Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Friday Live here at my YouTube channel. Thank you so much for joining me today. Hold on. I'm starting to record these lives on my regular camera so that I can share them in 4K for the edited replay. So I had to start my camera there. I almost forgot. So welcome, welcome. Welcome to this week's live stream here at my YouTube channel. Thank you so much for joining me. There are so many of you in the chat. Thanks for coming in and spending a little bit of time with me on this Friday, kind of midday. Thanks so much for joining me. In today's video or live stream, I'm going to be creating a birthday card. I never have enough birthday cards, so this is right up my alley. In fact, I need a birthday card next week for my sister, so I don't know if this will be the one that I give her. I'm not sure yet, because I have quite a stash of birthday cards to choose from, but this just might end up being her birthday card. So today, I'm using this stamp set called Candles. This is from the Stamp Timbre release from Simon. And then I'm also going to revisit this one that I used a few weeks ago in a live stream called Circle Sayings. And we're not going to use the die today. We're just going to be creating, this is actually mostly a one layer card. It's just going to have one layer popped up on some foam tape. But other than that, it's going to be pretty smooth, no lumps and bumps, anything like that. Hello, everyone in the chat. We've got Vicky. Let's see, Nancy, Linda, Jennifer, let's see, Ina, maybe? I'm not sure how to say your name. Tracy, Amory, lots of really fun names coming in here. Cherie, I did want to give you guys an update on the giveaway winner from last week. The giveaway winner is Sarah Clark. And I emailed her this morning and she responded right away. She has claimed her prize. So that Lawn Fawn pack of goodies will be mailed off to Sarah probably the beginning of next week. I just wanted to give you guys a kind of a follow-up to that so you all knew. And I was actually really excited when I drew the winner because I always go to random.org and just put in the number of entries and then whatever number it pops up randomly, I go find that person and that's who it is. Well, guess what? This person, Sarah, must have been watching live last week because she was number 22. Yeah, she was number 22 and she did. She entered it in right away, right after the giveaway was live. So I was really excited about that. So thank you guys that watch every week. And I'm not sure if Sarah's here. I'm kind of watching the chat here. She might be. I don't know. We were emailing this morning kind of back and forth and she sent me her mailing address. So big congrats to Sarah with an H. Thanks so much for joining. So here we go. Let's get into this. I wanted to do some watercoloring, maybe some really colorful watercoloring. So I'm going to set this stamp set aside and this one too. Actually, we are going to stamp this first. I was thinking I'd do the watercoloring first. But no, I think I want to do the stamping first this time. Actually, do I? I don't. We're going to put that aside. All right, I've got some watercolor paper here. This is cut to 5x7. This is Canson XL watercolor paper. And I'm going to grab a hardboard. And we're going to tape this down. So the idea for my card is I want like lots and lots of color at the bottom, really colorful rainbow. And then I want it to be very light in the center and then kind of fade up. And then I'm going to be stamping that circle saying up in the top corner. That's the plan. We'll see how it goes. Because as we know, sometimes you get watercoloring and the watercolor tells you what it wants to do that day. Sometimes you have no control. The watercolor will do whatever it wants. All right, I'm also using a new watercolor set. New to me, anyway. I think it's been out for a while. I'm not entirely sure how long it's been out. But many of you might remember a couple years ago, I sort of had an obsession with the Prima watercolor confection sets, in particular the tropical set. I don't even know if they still sell that anymore. But I was looking for another set kind of like that. And Prima has a new set under their art philosophy line. This is watercolor confetti set. It's an introduction set. has some really fun colors on the back. I just picked this up at simonsstamp.com. It's available in many other stores and shops, and I thought I'd try these out today. Vicky's asking, why use hot press versus cold press watercolor paper? Sometimes it's just personal preference. Cold press tends to have a little bit more texture, and it can also handle a little bit more water. So a lot of people, as a rule, start with cold press watercolor paper just because it's slightly more forgiving. When you use hot press watercolor paper, it's generally thinner and smoother, and it's great, but it can't handle large amounts of water all in one go. So that's mainly the reason why. And I just have more cold press paper on hand in general. So anyway, this is the Canson XL paper. So here is that Art Philosophy set, and look how fun this is. When you open it up, it has an overlay that tells you what the colors are. Isn't that fun? So you can just set this aside and save it. It does come with a water brush and also this sponge down here, which I believe, I'm not entirely sure of the exact, intent for a sponge like this. I've had it in a couple different watercolor sets. I think it's to clean your brush off of, like use it to clean your brush. So you wet the sponge if you want to, and then you can rub your brush against it and it will clean it off. These are just empty. I think they're meant to put a little bit of water. This is kind of like a travel set. I don't know. We're not traveling today. We're just painting at home, but we're going to go ahead and try out these colors, and they look pretty promising. I don't know. We'll see. So here's my little watercolor set off to the side. You know what? I don't do this all that often, but I'm going to today. I'm just going to spritz this with a water bottle just to get those colors all wet. And I do have my cup of water. We'll just put that up there. And I'm going to grab a paper towel. All right. So like I said, I want to have it be really colorful at the bottom and kind of go up. I'm going to take my little card here and put it up here to reference, although I can kind of see what the colors look like right here. As far as paintbrushes go, I want something a little bit bigger than I normally use. We'll do a size 8. Got a little bit of white gouache that's stuck on the barrel of the brush here, but that's okay. All right, I'm going to start with yellow. Let's see, I'm trying to think here. I'm trying to think because I want to make sure I have room for the circle at the top. All right, we're just going to go in here. I'm going to do lemon yellow. Well, first, like right off the bat, the color is very creamy. I like that. All right, let's just get going here. I'm going to have a little yellow up at the top. This is going to be very, what's the word I'm looking for? Kind of a random. I don't have a particular plan. I just want to start adding color. Oh, this pink looks really pretty. Ooh, that is pretty. That is a really pretty pink. All right, I'm going to transition to kind of like a purple. Oh, that's pretty. I like that. We'll do this kind of bright blue. It looks really like a cyan blue or a really good sky. And it's creeping into the orange, not a big deal. Let's get a little bit of that going right here. And then let's grab this green, kind of a tealish blue-green. And then we'll grab this darker blue just to finish off this corner down here at the bottom. Okay, I think that looks pretty good. The colors aren't as transparent as some of my other watercolors that I have, but they're not bad. They're pretty great. So I'm going to hit this with my heat tool just to speed up the drying process. And then I think I want to do one more layer of color. Someone in the comments said that they sort of look milky like oxides. I think Deb said that. I think that's a very accurate description for these watercolors. They're very creamy. They're not, I love that they're not really grainy. A lot of people that watercolor, they kind of love that grain look. I know Debbie Hughes really loves that, especially with Daniel Smith watercolors. That's not my jam. I want smooth color. All right, I'm going to grab, let's see, let's what these oranges look like. It's like, I kind of want a little bit more orange. In fact, you know what? I'm going to move this off here and I can use this as my palette. There we go. That's what I was missing. I'm like, I miss like putting the color out and seeing what it looks like. All right, I'm watering it down quite a bit because I don't want it to be too opaque, but I'm just going to kind of bring in this orange here. I'm also going to water it down quite a bit. In fact, maybe I'll bring in some of that yellow and water that down as well, because I just want this to sort of fade off up at the top. I'll grab a little bit of a brighter green, and I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. I just want to add a little bit of a variation of color right through here. And I'm going to grab this bright red. I call it wild strawberry. These color names are great. Just bring it down through here. Oh yeah, I needed that pop of bright red. I love that. So I was going to initially die cut this down so it was smaller, but now I'm kind of loving it. Hold on, I'm going to grab this, these colors over here because I'm referencing quite a bit. I was going to cut this down, but I'm loving all the color variation that's happening. So I don't think I will. I do want to add a little more in that area. So I think I'm going to grab the purple and really water that down like I've done with the others and just bring this across. Just like that, just to get a little bit of a variation. Okay, I'm loving these colors. I wasn't sure with that first layer, but these are really pretty. I like them. I'm not sure what's happening right there. There was a little tiny dot of something. I'm trying to decide if I want to mess with it or if I just want to let it be. Let's dry it with my heat tool and then maybe use an X-Acto knife and see if we can scratch some of that dot off. Well, we'll see. Dry. I'm just gonna kind of feel it. So that's it for all of you. If you want to know if your paper's completely dry, go ahead and like after you've used your heat tool or if you're air drying it, just give it a little tap with your palm of your hand. And if you have any cooler spots, like some colder areas, those are not dry. And I'm not getting any cool spots. So I think we're good. So I'm gonna stop there for the watercolor. I'm going to move on to the rest of the card. This is going to be a really quick card today. All right, and then we're going to see if we can scrape off some of that color on that little dot. We'll see if it works. Okay, so I haven't used all the colors in this set yet, but my initial reaction, thumbs up. I really like it, and it was fairly inexpensive. I have no idea how long it's been out. Good job, Prima. I like it. Set that aside to dry. I always let the palettes dry completely before I close them up, especially if I've put anything on the lid. In fact, you know what? This is really, really watery. So I'm just gonna go ahead and clean it up. Just a quick wipe of my paper towel and that'll clean that up. Okay, now I can close it, but not really because I wanna keep that. So I'm just gonna let the actual paints dry. And we're going to look at this here. Even if I get it to just scrape off to like a white of the paper, I think it would look better. Because that dot is just, that's all I see. That is all I see when I look at this. So we're just going to try to... Oh, it's already lightening. Yay. It's already looking better. Look at that. Such light little scrapes. Okay, it's not going away completely, but not bad. I think I can live with it like this now. Yay, it's almost completely gone. I can live with it now. I can live with it now. Okay, so I am going to, okay, I just got to decide. Am I going to trim this down? I kind of love how big it is. Okay, let's see here. So the plan is to use these candle stamps. They're going to go at the bottom there. And then the birthday stamp, let's just get it out. And we're going to play here for a little bit, see what we like. The birthday was going to go like right up here in just the white, but it could possibly come down right here too. I'm just trying to get a good idea of what's happening here. If I made it a full 5x7, I'd have the candles down here. I could possibly have the happy birthday right there. I could make it work. The watercolors that I use today are the Art Philosophy from Prima. It's their watercolor confetti set for those that are just coming into the live. All right, I'm trying to decide how exactly am I doing this. If I did that, it would be smaller. I could make it a square card. I'm just trying to think through the logistics of this. Huh. All right. Let's, and I also need to decide if the candles are going to be white embossed, gold embossed, or black. I'm kind of thinking gold, and then possibly doing the happy birthday in gold also. I can't decide. All right. While we're deciding, I'll get out my MISTI. Okay. I cleaned off my glass mat today, right before going live, and it is so clean right now. It's so pristine. I love it so much. Okay. Oh, I just don't even want to cover any of that up. It's so pretty. Okay, let's revisit this. I could have it be a sideways card and have the candles coming in on the bottom. And then I could have this greeting up here. I could do that. That could be fun. No, I want it to be a tall card. Take this out so I can use my cling stamp. And I'm also going to use a sticky mat from my sweet petunia. And that's just so I can put my project directly in the center of the stamping area. Use the magnet, and then I can have the candles go off the edge if I need to. Okay. The watercolor is so pretty. I don't want to cover it. Someone just said acetate overlay. That is brilliant. Who said that? MJ Chang. Love it. Let's figure that out. Because then I don't have to get rid of any of it. Okay. All right. I think we're still going to need this actually to stamp on the acetate. However, I figure this out. How am I doing the acetate? Or vellum even? Let's do acetate. I've got to come over and grab some. And the Simon Says stamp acetate is heat resistant, so that's perfect. All right. Ta-da. Someone's saying a shaker. I could possibly make it a shaker. That is true. I'm going to cut this. If I can get this to come off. I'm going to cut this down to, let's see, if we want it to be the full, oh gosh, how do we want to do this? Okay, so the watercolor is smaller than 5x7 because I did tape off the edges. So it's going to be a little bit smaller than a 5x7 card. How do I want to do this? I really want the acetate to be like the full front of the card, and then you open it up. So this would be the front of the card. So I think I'm gonna have to have the acetate fold back, and the card itself will be a little bit smaller. Let's go ahead and trim down the watercolor piece. So this is not going to be a traditional 5x7 size. It's actually going to be more like 4.5 by 6.5. Okay, so there's the front. So, all right, do I have any washi tape? I find washi tape is a great way to just add to put the spine on the acetate, and then it could also have a little bit of color on this one edge. Where do I have all my washi tape? Where am I hiding it? Or I could just stamp something to hide the where it adheres. Hold on, I have to walk to my office. I don't have all of my stationery, like tape, washi stuff, all in my craft room. It's in my office. Okay. There's the washi tape. I haven't looked at this washi tape in ages, but I know the one that I'm thinking of. Okay. Some of you who've been around for a long time will recognize this washi tape container that I got at the Container Store a million years ago. So, actually, we'll deal with that in a minute. We're going to go ahead and stamp our candles first. But I'm cutting my acetate to be the exact size of the front of this right here. Okay, so it was 4.5. By 6.5. Okay, so now it's the exact size of that front. Oh, that's going to be great. Okay. Some are saying they would score the acetate and fold it back. I would, except this is really thick acetate, and I don't think it would actually fold back. So that's why I'm instead choosing to just have it be on there, and I'm gonna add it like a washi tape spine to it so that it can open. So that's the plan. All right, I'm gonna put this Oh my word, I'm not gonna be able to even see where it is. Believe me, it's there somewhere. I'm gonna have to like get in the light, go down there and look at it. Okay, so we're gonna have these candles right there at the bottom. All right, and then we are adding, I'm afraid, you know what, it probably will stick to that. I don't know, do I want to add powder? I think I will. I'll just do a little bit of powder right across there. Hopefully that'll help any of the embossing powder from sticking. And then VersaMark Ink. In fact, you know what? Let's go ahead and do the powder up here at the top too, because then I can heat it all at the same time. I'll stamp the greeting up there too in a minute. All right, make sure that's in the corner. I'm just gonna walk my fingertips over all of this and then lift up. Okay, I can see the candles on there. They are lovely. And then I'm gonna put my foam pad back in. I'll remove this. And I'm gonna like look in the light to try to see where I'm positioning all this. And I also wanna think about exactly where, okay, it needs to be about right there. I think that would do it. The circle's gonna be kind of skewed a little bit. Let's do a little bit of powder right over that area, making sure I'm not touching where the candle stamping is. And then just a quick little stamp. I'm trying to not squish it down because the happy on happy birthday is a very small type. Okay, that's perfect. All right, so I'm going to try to avoid touching anything down at the bottom. I'm only doing the top here. And I'm bending back my sticky mat more than the acetate. Okay, you guys see that? You can see the candles on there now. And we're gonna do it in gold. Let's get this out of the way first. This could be dangerous. Okay. Everyone cross your fingers so that we don't have like powder sticking everywhere. This could be really bad. Well, we'll see. I'm gonna have to go shake this out over a trash can, I think. All right, it's looking real bad. I'm gonna go shake this out over a trash can because I'm afraid to tap it too much. Okay, and have the powder go everywhere. Okay, most of it's coming off. Most of it is coming off. There's still quite a bit, but most of it is coming off, and I could probably clean the rest off with a brush. I'm just gonna keep tapping it for a minute. Cause it's like if I tap directly over where there's powder, that it comes off. So I just have to keep tapping from the back. Now I think it's to the point where I'm just gonna have to use a brush to clean off those areas. And it's somewhat hard to see, but we're getting there, right? I think it's gonna be worth it. Embossing powder on acetate is a pain, or it can be a pain. But when it's done right, it looks so good. And I probably should have done that trick where you like wet it down. Okay. Oh, if I tip it like this, then I can actually see in the light where I'm brushing away. So we'll do that. This is like card surgery. There's also powder on the back. It's like everywhere. Wow. Okay. I've got to get this off the back of it. How can I do this? I'm going to do... Okay, now we can see it, right? I'll just do this and hopefully that'll get most of the powder off the back. Oh, I just got my finger in it. Good job, Christina. Okay. It's just going everywhere now. Paper towel seems to take off more because I can wipe it completely off. It's collecting on my mat, but that's okay. Oh my word, there is so much on the back too. Oh, I don't know if it would be worth it just to start over. It might be. Or we just embrace the embossing powder and decide we're gonna go with it and we'll have little sparkly gold bits all over. Which is an option. All right, I'm gonna switch to a smaller brush and see if I can get some of this off. Yeah, it really doesn't want to come off. It moves and just gets attracted to another spot. Also, I think it would have been better if I stamped the candles, embossed it, and then stamped the greeting. Because then I could wipe off everything off the top. Does that make sense? I also wonder if my brush was wet, so it would make the embossing powder stick. Would that, wetting my brush. That does kind of work. All right, I'm gonna try to pick up some of the stuff up here. All right, well, it's either going to be ruined or it's going to look awesome. So I think I'm just going to go ahead and heat emboss it. And if I really don't like it, then we're going to try to do it one more time and use some of those preventative steps that I've actually used in the past with great success. So I don't know why it was just like gung-ho. Let's just do it. Okay. Well, let's just go ahead and keep this. It's going to be a mess. I'm just letting you know. Yeah, it is a little bit of a mess, but but we're getting the idea, right? So then it would be like this right over the top. I do like that, but I don't like the messy embossing. So let's try a couple of tips that people use. Oh, I've got embossing powder everywhere. Oh my word. The powder just goes everywhere. I'm usually not one to have huge messes of with embossing powder. So I can't stand this. Okay. Baby wipe. That'll get it. Okay. Wipe that down. Yes, I like how it's looking. I just didn't like how everything was sticking to it. Okay, so this is when I need Jennifer. She always has really good tips on stuff like this. Okay, so this is where I'm going, and then I'm going to have gold washi tape down that one side, so it will, you know, you can still open it. That's the idea anyway. All right, so let's cut that acetate one more time. Alrighty, it is 6.5 by 4.5. Make sure that's the right size. Looking good. Okay, so what I've done in the past is like spritzed both sides and then dried off with a paper towel and then stamp. And that seems to help quite a bit. So, I don't remember if this is still on here, but we'll just have to redo this. Oh, I forget. We're spritzing. We're spritzing, Christina. What are you doing? Okay. Moving this to the side. I'm gonna... Oh, I should have got a paper towel handy. Oops. I don't have enough hands. And then someone's saying powder on both sides. Okay. All right, we'll try that. There's something about having the water on it, like right before, like cuts down on any of the static cling. I'm gonna get more paper towel. Hold on. All right, so now I can go like this and get both sides. Trying to not touch it as much as I can. All right, and then we're going to apply a generous amount of powder. Well, okay, one side, put the sticky side down, and then put more powder on top. That's what we're doing. Okay. All right. Lots of powder. Into the MISTI, and the only corner I'm touching is the one that will be the top corner, and this bottom corner. Place that down. Okay. And then if I'm going to touch it anymore, I'm using a paper towel just to press that down. This is still pretty much in the right spot, but we're going to do them separately this time because we are learning from our mistakes, right? Okay, so we're gonna do the candles first. And I did not clean this off, so let's clean this off real quick. Clean that off. Oh my word, what is all over my stamp here? It's being weird. All right, make sure that's got no wet spots. And then I'm gonna look down, see where I need to put this. Pick that up. All right, and it actually left a spot already. I can see it in the light. That's cute. All right, is it gonna stamp in the exact same spot? Maybe, who knows? We might be messing this up even more. All right. Get lots of powder. We're really going to be generous with that. All right. And then we'll stamp this again. I'm not real confident. I am only 65% confident. All right, let's try this again. I forgot to take my foam pad out. We're rolling with it. Whatever. Okay. I did get a little bit of a double stamp. I can already tell. I can see in the light. Y'all, seriously. I'm not even gonna try. Goodbye, acetate. Trying again. It's one of those moments where I'm glad I have a whole pack of acetate to go through. Okay. 6.5 by 4.5. But now that that stamp's in the right spot, I won't move it. Okay. Move that out of the way. Paper towel. Put that down. Spritz, 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 spritz. If I remember correctly, when Jennifer McGuire uses the little water technique, she like really douses it in water. Like you want it dripping. Like you want water to drip off just like that. And for some reason, that just like takes away any of the static cling or prevents a lot of it. Someone in the comments said that they use alcohol wipes. That's a great option too. All right, I'm just making sure everything's dry. Someone's saying no sticky mat. Well, it's a sticky mat now because I'm too far in. Okay. I just have to make sure that, let's see, we're going to put that there. This line comes across. I just need to make sure that it's hanging off about right there and that'll be perfect. Okay. Press that down. Powder. Forgot to powder the back. Whatever. We'll see. Adding lots of powder. Can also take that out. People are saying, no sticky mat, no sticky mat. Yeah, the mat was probably causing the stickiness on the back. That is true. I'm too far in, guys. I can't. It's already stuck down. It's too late. Okay. At least the candles will be stamped nice, right? I do have a new sticky mat that I could just sacrifice to the crafting gods. I could sacrifice this one and not remove it till after the embossing powder's on it. I could do that. Okay. Do I want to do that? Maybe. Maybe not. I don't know. All right. I've got my happy birthday stamp here. And I don't want any of that to get on there. So what we're going to do, where's my little grid transparency? All right, got my grid transparency. I'm just going to use that to get this positioned just about right. Oh, see, that's why I did that. And then Yeah, that's about right. Oh, I forgot to put the foam pad in. That's okay. We can put it in now. All right. Put the foam pad back in. And we're going to do more powder up here. I might be repeating mistakes I had before, but I'm too far in, guys. And then stamp that down. Kathy, I'm supposed to go and exercise, but this is riveting. I need to bring the iPad to the treadmill. Anything for you, Kathy. All right. So to protect the back, I'm just going, this mat was already losing a lot of stickiness to begin with. I'm just sacrificing it to this card today. I think it will be worth it. I have additional sticky mats that I can use. It was starting to lose the stick, and I mean, it was dirty, you guys. So we'll just go with it. And you know what else I'm going to do? Where'd it go? I'm going to put grid paper down. I'm going to put grid paper down, and then I can just, if embossing powder falls, it falls. It falls. I'm just going to tape this down. Okay. All right. Here we go. Going to try to prevent any of the embossing powder from going where it doesn't need to go. So here we go. This also gives me handles to hold on to. Oh, guys, this is so much better. So much better. Do you see that? It's so much better. I can't believe how much better that is. The water did the trick, I think. Okay, and then just putting this all the way along the side here. Shake that off. It looks real bad right now, but as you start tapping it, it's so much better. It's so much better, it's not even funny. I think also having something rigid right here is helping. I do have some little powder spots kind of sticking around, but for the most part, it is lots better. Look at that. Okay, I'm gonna go tap this over my garbage can. I think that's gonna get rid of anything else. Then I can really tap it really hard. Okay, and then where'd that little brush go? I get my little brush wet and I can clean off this stuff that's just hanging around. For the most part, it is so much cleaner. Oh, you guys. Now, if you want to reuse your sticky mat, I would not recommend this method. But you know what? It's working really great. I can't complain about that. Okay. All right. And now I have something to hold on to when I heat set it. Like I said, sacrificing the mat. Interestingly, it's taking a longer, you know what? I take it back. I'm going to have to remove it because it's just taking so long to heat. Okay. Here we go. Now we can heat it. There we go. Okay. Overall, so much better. Like I want to show you guys. I don't know if you can see it on camera, but the difference. Anyway. So much better. All right. So now we need to start putting, oh, and look, now I can just do this. There's gold embossing powder on that. No big deal. I can just do this. Also could have just put out paper towels, I suppose. And RIP sticky mat in the trash. Worth it. Okay, so I did have quite a bit of powder. Let me show you this up close. I had lots of powder down here at the bottom that I couldn't see, but I was mostly worried about all this area up here and inside the grating. But now that that's taken care of, it looks great. So let's get a card base out. And we're gonna cut it down so it's the right size. So I'm just gonna make it 4.5 by 6.5. I already have my card base folded and everything, so I'm just cutting one down. All right. And let's see. I think I'm going to go ahead and adhere this first, and then we can adhere that directly on the front. So, going back to the washi tape, wherever that went, here we go. All right. I have a bunch of washi tape that I can choose from. I'm thinking gold might go well, or maybe even the black. I think a black would be really, really nice. Maybe like this or polka dot. I think either one of those would be good. All this washi tape is so old, I'm sure it's not even available anymore. Okay, that would be really cute, the really colorful gold. Let's see, we can do gold stars. We could even just do a little stripey one. Maybe something super colorful like this. No, that's too much. I'm kind of thinking maybe, well, this is kind of nice, just this plain. This card took a turn I was not expecting. You know what? I think black polka dot's probably a safe bet. It's going to be a really, really thin strip because it has to wrap around. So I think black with white polka dots is probably a safe choice. So this is what you do. And I've done a card like this in the past. All right, hold on. I think I unraveled that before because it was a little too not sticky. All right. Let's move this. All right, so what I'm gonna do is line these up, and then I can just place the tape. Well, I need them straight though, according to my mat. We're not gonna worry about that one for a minute. We'll just do just this one. And let's see here, about halfway, doesn't really matter. We just need a little bit. Wow, that's really sticky on the glass. Okay. Then I can lay this one right over the top. And we'll wrap that. I probably should have wrapped a little bit more, but that's okay. It'll get glued down. It'll be okay. All right, and then now we have this little thing that can open and close. And before we do anything else, we're gonna cover that up with more of the tape. But it's gonna be a little bit too wide, so I'm gonna cut it down. Oh, I shouldn't have done that. This tape really stuck to this glass. Dang it. Yeah, see, that was not smart. I should have stuck it to something else. Well, I guess if it goes onto the watercolor, it's not that bad, not that big of a deal. This is how I clean up my glass mat, y'all. But I guess that really shows how sticky that washi tape is. It's just like a comedy of errors today. But you know what, though? I'll gladly make all the mistakes for you guys. You guys can just sit back and enjoy. Okay. We'll just put this right over the top. Who cares? All right. Yay. Okay, that looks really good. Because then you can still open and close it. And taking scissors, just cut that off. It was a roundabout way, but we got there. We got there eventually. Okay. It's going to really bug me, especially because I just told you guys I cleaned my mat. That's okay. I'll clean it off more later. All right. Time to just adhere that down to the card base. And then we'll be done. So this is going directly down onto the card. And I'm getting my adhesive really close to the edge so that I don't have any areas that are peeling up. And I also want to make sure I get it on top of that washi tape over there on the side. Someone in the comment says, it's kind of comforting to see that even a professional has challenges and how you're handling it. Well, this, you know, this is what happens when people who are coming up with content for classes and things like that, we go through all of this just off camera. Coming up with techniques and figuring out what works and what doesn't. Ah, I love how that turned out. I'm so glad I did the overlay. I mean, it was a journey, but I'm still glad I did it. Okay, so now you can actually, I mean, well, if you open up the card like that, it's fine, but you can also open it like that. In fact, if you wanted to, you could like do a little hidden something in there. I don't know how you would really hide it because there's a lot of space in between the candles, but not bad. I like that it kind of looks like a book. Looks fun. All right. So that is the card for today. I'm just going to continue cleaning this up for a minute because I cannot handle all this adhesive everywhere. I'm going to have to go get some alcohol so I can get it to all come up. Anyway, thank you guys for joining me today. I'm going to do a little spiel for those who are watching the edited replay, and then I'll hang out for just a few minutes and answer some more questions. So here's the card for today. You can see the gold embossing looks really pretty. I think the overlay was worth it in the end, even though it did take quite a bit of time to get that going. But the washi tape turned out really well. I just love that watercolor so much, I didn't want to completely cover it up. So I think this is a innovative way to do that. And we're left with a finished card. So thanks so much for joining me. Make sure you check out all of the supplies that are listed down below in the video description. I'll have the candle stamp as well as the greeting stamp and those watercolors that I tried out today. The washi tape, it might be a lost cause. There are probably other polka dot washi tapes out there, but this one is so old, I don't know that I'll be able to find it. So if I find something, I'll link to it, but most likely not. But thank you so much for joining me. I will see you guys. Let's see, I think, oh gosh, well, I'll see you Monday for a card. I'm using Concord and Ninth stuff on Monday. And then I think Tuesday night, I have a stamp timber collaboration set from one of the companies I'm not naming because it's all very secretive, but I'll have a card with that collaboration set and that'll go up Tuesday night. So thanks so much for joining me. I will see you guys in another video very soon. All right. I can stop the recording up here because that's for the edited replay. And now I'm just going to go through these comments here. I've been sitting here for so long that my watercolor palette is almost dry. I love how this turned out, but oh my word, it was an experience. Vicky, this car took 10 years off my life. Too funny. Okay. Let's see, I'm trying to figure out what you guys were talking about. Deb says, I'd love it if an event planner would hold a craft festival, get a hotel and do a 2 or 3 day live crafting in a hotel conference room like quilters do, have all the craft gurus and we all craft live. You know, I want to say Scrapbook Expo does something similar, or they used to, like maybe pre-pandemic, and they would do all-night crafts. Do you guys remember crafts? They would do all-night crafts. It was something similar, but I don't know of anyone who does that currently. Anyway. Oh, thank you, Spirit Junkie. Spirit Junkie says, I am having one of those problem-solving days too. I admire your tenacity today to keep moving forward. Bravo. Thank you. It doesn't happen all the time, but a lot of times when I like get a certain look in my head and it just takes a while to get there. Other times, as I go along, it does something different and I kind of like where it goes and I just run with it. But this one was very specific. Well, I guess an example of that is I wasn't planning to not cover up the watercolor. I was planning to have it covered up all along. But when I saw how beautiful that turned out, I didn't want to. Okay, this knife does better. Because I can bend it. Now I can clean this all up. That adhesive really just sticks. Oh my gosh. Okay. Christina, stop obsessing over the mat. Okay. I'm fixating. going through comments. Oh my word, yes. This reminds me of the time you tried to die cut snowflakes on glitter paper and it just didn't want to cut. Took 3 to 4 tries before you succeeded. Yes. Oh my gosh. That must have been a holiday card series live stream either last year or the year before. It was intense. Okay, scrolling back down. Let's see here. Yes, says MJ says, congratulations. I'm glad my suggestion worked out. Me too, because I think it was worth it. Okay. La la la. Barbara says, I use a razor blade on my glass top stove. The safety razor blades with holders are the best. I need to get something like that for my glass mat here in my craft room. That's what I need. The replay won't be the same without the comments. I'm pretty sure a lot of you were freaking out in the comments. I wasn't watching as close, but I was seeing you all say, don't use the sticky mat, don't use the sticky mat. And then, don't forget the foam. You were like screaming at me as I'm making mistake after mistake. Too funny. Tammy asks, when will you begin holiday cards? Well, I've done holiday cards kind of here and there already, but my holiday card series starts the Friday before Halloween. So that's when it will be dedicated holiday all the time. Let's see here. Beth says, I didn't really have time for this today, but so glad I watched. Thanks for joining me, Beth. I'm glad you liked it. My hubby just had to call it the reveal. Well, I'm glad you can rewind. I'm wondering if you tried the watercolor paper upside down. I don't understand. I'm not sure what you're asking. Are you talking about when I had the watercolor thing face down and I was putting the tape on? I don't know. Or are you asking if I paint with it turned over. So I'm painting on the back of the watercolor paper if I've tried that. I have done that before. It's just, it's similar. It's just a different look. So what would you do for message on the inside, right on the back? What do you mean? Oh, you mean if I was going to do something like a little secret thing on this? You could write something like on the back, I think with like a black Sharpie, a thin black Sharpie. I think that could be kind of fun, kind of a hidden message. But other than that, it's just a regular card. Let's see here. You could heat set the sticky mat and maybe you could still use it. Maybe. I don't know. That one was, it was losing tons of its stick. And I don't think, I mean, I had not treated it well. It had seen its day. So it was probably time to retire that one anyway. Oh, Anne says Expo is doing their crops again. Good. How many watercolor paint sets do you have? Way too many. I don't know what way too many means as a number, but way too many, especially because I've really just like fallen into a few that I use most. I think this is going to be a set that I'm going to go to quite a bit. Because if I remember correctly, it was a very like approachable price. It was like wallet friendly. I'm going to go check. I don't know if any of you have like looked already, but I have Simon's stamp pulled up. So I'll just look up watercolor confetti and see what comes up. It's $25. It's a $25 set. So it's very, you know, budget friendly. It's a good one. Why don't you try folding the acetate over so that it wraps down the spine and into the back of the card? I answered that a little bit earlier, but just in case you weren't here during that when I answered it, this is very, very thick acetate. It would not fold well. It's very thick. It wouldn't fold well. I mean, you could try it. I know some people have, but I don't know that it would have a good result. It would probably constantly be open because it couldn't fold all the way. I've done it before. I just find that it's more hassle than it's worth. So I'd much rather do a solution, something like this where you tape it down or something like that. Let's see. Any other questions? I love how we thought this was going to be a fast video, but I was able to make 3 cards and a few favors. I don't know what you were making, but if you were able to make 3 cards and a few favors in this hour that I have made this one card, you're amazing. I love it. Okay. Let's see. Oh, yeah. Shaman remembers, loved Scrapbook Expo Midnight Crop Party. Yeah. Let's see. Oh, and Katie says, Scrapbook Expo was my very first exposure to all this about 15 years ago. They were awesome. I know they still are around, and it sounds like they're still doing it, so it's amazing. Let's see. You got the time to swatch the other colors in the palette for us? Sure. I think when I edit this down, I'm going to edit down so it's a little bit, like quite a bit shorter. I'm going to cut out all of the stressful parts. Let's do this. This will just be a really quick swatch. Let's see, how many colors are there? 24. There's 24. So actually, I was going to do this quick, but maybe we'll just go ahead and make it an actual real swatch chart. And in that case, I'm going to use a pencil and draw out grids. So if we make this like half an inch. Okay. One, two, three, four, five, six. Perfect. So what I'm going to do is just draw a really quick grid, and then I can paint all the colors within it. And then I'll cut it down and I can keep it inside the tin. All right, so this one, we only need 4. This would be a really small swatch chart. But it will give us a good idea of what the colors look like when they're actually painted. Because even though it does have that clear overlay, it doesn't show any variation in color. So let me grab a smaller brush. And I'm also gonna need some paper towels. And let's go ahead and just spritz that. I'm not gonna swatch the white because, I mean, what's the point? In fact, let's do this. We'll go over here. Oh my word, my paint has blue on it, or my brush has blue on it. That's cute. Okay. We want pure color. Okay, there we go. And when I do kind of like a swatch chart like this, I like to do like a full strength of color and then start fading it out as it comes to the other side. I'm gonna switch the color right next to it. And then I'll go to this one. I don't know what this color is. I hope they didn't call it. Okay, yeah, it's called Melon. That's a pretty good name for that one. And then just have it fade out to the other side. All right, I'm gonna zoom in here. This next one is called Wild Strawberry. That is a really pretty red. Added a little too much water on that, but that's okay. We're gonna get it to spread out. A little more of that color. There we go. I'm gonna scroll down the comments because I know I've missed quite a bit. Oh, I do need one more row. I do. You guys in the comments were like, you don't have enough rows there, girl. It's true, I don't. Okay, there we go. All right, so now I'm gonna do the opposite colors or the opposite corner colors. This is a very golden yellow. It looks orange in the palette. Seriously, look at that. It's this color right here. It looks orange. It's like nacho cheese orange. Okay, so that color was marigold and this one is just orange. It's just called orange. And I think it really is a very true orange color. So I like to do my swatches like this so you can get like full strength color and you can also see what, you know, when it's watered down, what it looks like. Okay, this one's just called pink. And this is the one that I used on my watercolor painting today. And it's not very transparent. It's pretty opaque. I don't know if you can see that. It's like a very creamy, kind of almost chalky color. Generally, those aren't my favorite, but I do like the color. So it's kind of winning me over. All right. We're down to denim. I'm getting a little more of that. Just painting this all the way down. I'm curious if it's going to have some good browns, because browns and greens, those are what make or break watercolor palettes for me, because I always like a warm brown and a cool brown, and I also like a bunch of greens. There's a couple greens in here. We'll see. Okay, this next one is teal. Which does not look like teal to me. This looks like a, I think they, what do they call it? Normally like a viridian green. But I like it. I just don't know that I'd call it teal. Teal to me has a little more blue tint to it. All right, going on to this last one on this row, which is called lime green. Which I think is almost more like a sap green in like traditional watercolor names. All right, we're to black. We'll see how black this actually is. It's very black. I like that these colors, or these paints, they do activate really quickly. Like, I'm not having to sit there and add more and more water and really swirl around in the pan. They are activating very quickly. Speaking of amazing paints, I ordered, I could not help myself, and I ordered some more Yuli watercolors. I think it might be her original Christmas set from a couple of years ago. And she's added a bunch of color scents. Sorry, I need to get a drink of water. She's added a bunch of scents. And I've been just getting the colors kind of piecemeal and putting it together a little bit here and there. And I was like, I really just want like half pans of all of these colors because they're the ones I use the most often. So I ordered the rest of the colors I didn't have. And they're coming today. I'm so excited. That color is wood. And then we're going on to the color sand, which I would actually call yellow ochre. I would not call it sand, but it's kind of nice that there are some like traditional watercolor colors in this set. They've just renamed them, given them a little bit more life. But what's that saying? A rose by any other name is still a rose. All right, so there's sand, and then most of this is dry up here, but let's do this with a heat tool just to make sure everything is dry. That pink shade dried down to such a pretty color. All right, so let's go back up to the yellows. Now we're going into the one that is called yellow. There is no other name, just yellow. I've got a little too much water going there, so I'm sopping it up with my brush. These yellows look very, very similar. Did we need both yellows? Maybe. All right, This next one is called Cherry. I'm just getting enough of it on here. Oh, that's a pretty red. That's like Christmas red to me, like a very cool toned, bright red. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's Christmas red for me. Because for my Christmas cards, I need a really good red. That's a good one. Okay, now we're going to go to papaya. This looks kind of like a orangey yellow. It looks almost like the color right before it. No, it's a little more orange than yellow, actually. I take that back. It's a little different. Okay, this next color is called Carnation, and I think I'm gonna really love this color. It's kind of like you see that right there? It's kind of like a really pretty pink. It's got the same kind of texture going that this color, this one does too, which is, it's not really transparent. It's pretty opaque, but I do like the color. I feel like maybe they've picked some colors that kind of update the color palette a little bit. And then this last color is Wild Rose. I think this is going to be the one that's more magenta. Yeah. It's like not quite an opera pink. It's really just like a magenta. Almost a fuchsia. And when you water it out, it does start to look more like an opera pink. I like that. That's really pretty. All right, coming up here, we're getting this blue shade called Sky. Getting that nice and mixed in. This is the color we used today. And it turned out really well. If I was to do like just a really simple rainbow watercolor and I wanted colors to mix with each other, I would do this yellow, the lemon yellow, the wild rose, and then sky. Those are like your CMY colors that I think would go great. All right, for this other blue, this is just blue. Called blue. That's it. No other descriptors, just blue. We'll see for ourselves. Is it really just blue? It might be. It's looking like a really good blue. Yeah, that is a really good blue. In fact, I might do that one instead of sky. If I was going to do just a simple rainbow watercolor. Just trying to get this to fade down a little bit. Okay. And the one lone purple. I think purple kind of gets bad rap when it comes to paints, because they're like, you know, you can make your own purple, use some red and blue. But having a purple already made is so nice. This one seems a little chalky, not quite as transparent as some of the other colors, but it is a really nice purple. Like, it doesn't really lean toward blue and doesn't really lean toward red. It's a pretty even purple. All right, let's try this one that's just called brown. That's it, brown. All right. So the one other brown that's right next to it was called wood, which was a warmer brown. So this one This one is kind of warm too. Interesting. They are two very different browns, but interesting. That one was, it's almost cooler in tone, more neutral. This one's a little more warm. All right, here's another green called Moss. So I mentioned earlier in today's live stream that I use the Prima watercolor confections in tropical all the time. And I think the reason why I got so familiar with that one was because I used it for my capsule paper crafting challenge. And I did a swatch chart of it and I mixed all the colors with each other to see what colors it could create. And I really got to know the palette well. And I think that's why. So I think I'm going to have to do that with this palette because it might be another go-to for me. Okay, this last color is called Anise. Anise? I'm not sure. But, oh, it's different. It's like a, it's just a slightly more golden yellow ochre, kind of. But it is very yellow. I'm like, why, do we need another yellow? We've got like four or five yellows in this thing. I mean, I guess you can use yellow to make different shades of things, but okay. All right, so here we are. I guess I could do this, go side by side, just like this. So there we go. Spirit Junkie, I definitely won't be embossing on acetate anytime soon. No way. Too funny. Anyway, this swatching was really fun. Yeah, that red is really gorgeous. I love that red. All right. I think I'm gonna call it. We've been on for about 90 minutes, which is about average for me. And we'll be done. I'm just going through the comments really quick to see if there's anything I need to answer. Oh, Andrea says maybe between opera pink and permanent rose. Yeah, that's a good, like, somewhere in between. Sylvia asks, are you using just one brush or two? How did you rinse the color so quickly? Yeah, just one brush, but it's a small one. So, you know, I just swished it in my cup of water really quick and then dab it off on a paper towel. That's just like my process. So, dabbing off the paper towel, like I can tell if there's any color left in the brush. And then if there is, then I'll go ahead and swish it in the water again. But that generally makes it go pretty quickly. Vicky says, it's hard to find good reds. Tim's distress line needs a good red. He does have some really good reds, but not like a really bright red that stays really bright. But I think that's hard because most of the times when we use like a really bright red, we want it to stay red, even if we're like fading it out. But really, red faded out is just pink. So it's hard. But I like candied apple if I want like a really, really bright red. I think candied apple's good. But I agree. I think there could be some other reds. Let's see here. Any other... Yes, a rose with any other name would smell as sweet. That's the quote I was looking for. Let's see here. I think I've caught most everything. Anise is used in a lot of perfumes. Huh. Is it like a flower? All right. Would you buy this palette again? You mean like this thing of paints? Would I buy it again? Yeah, I think I would. It's really nice. It's got a good mix of color. I want to do some swatch charts though and see how they mix. So we'll see how that goes. Anyway, thank you guys for joining me today. The card was a journey, but it turned out well. I love the watercolor. I'm so glad I didn't cover it all up. So fun. You can kind of see where some of those colors mixed. I think this was that red that I used right through there. You can kind of see that. They look really great all put together. You notice that there's some weird like patchiness happening through here. I think that's a combination of the paper and also the paint. Sometimes you can use a lesser quality paint with a higher quality paper and also vice versa, and you get better results. So, you know, it just really depends on what we do. But yeah, super fun. Thanks for joining me today. I'll be back next week with more card videos, and thanks for joining me.